Hello everyone, welcome to my channel. First, I would like to introduce myself briefly. My name is Micro Ivan. I am a network security engineer. The purpose of this channel is to share some of the issues I encounter in my daily work, and I hope to improve myself through this process. Today is my first video. If you have any comments or suggestions about my videos, feel free to leave a message in the comments section. I also hope to have more opportunities to communicate and interact with everyone. In this first video, I want to talk about the high availability of FortiGate firewalls. The reason I chose FortiGate is mainly because in recent years, FortiGate has been very popular. One main reason is its simple architecture, which is very easy to master. And crucially, it offers a very high cost-performance ratio. That's why it's favored by users of all sizes. High availability is also a feature we often use in regular network deployment and maintenance. But to fully understand high availability and make good use of it, there are some details that need attention. So today, I'd like to discuss this topic with you. First, let's take a look at what high availability is. As the name suggests, high availability provides a network that can continue to operate smoothly even when there are device failures within the network. So, for firewalls, for instance, under normal circumstances, we would have two firewalls forming a firewall cluster. If either of the two firewalls encounters a problem, the other can take over to handle the network traffic, thus ensuring the smooth operation of the entire network. So, when we start building a firewall cluster from scratch, we need to consider specific issues. Let's examine what configurations are required. Let's take a closer look together. Typically, a firewall cluster is commonly composed of two firewalls. These two firewalls must meet certain criteria to successfully complete the cluster setup. Firstly, we need to ensure that the two firewalls are of the same model and use the same firmware version. Sometimes we build a physical cluster, sometimes we build a virtual cluster. If it's a physical cluster, we must ensure both firewalls are physical firewalls. Similarly, for a virtual one, we must use two virtual firewalls. While ensuring the firmware and hardware versions are the same, we also need to ensure both firewalls use the same license. This ensures that both firewalls have the same features. Thus, during failover, there won't be any problems. Another point is, both firewalls must have the same hardware configurations and they must operate in the same mode. For instance, if you want to use VDOMs, then both firewalls must enable the VDOM feature. These are some basic considerations we must keep in mind when selecting equipment. Next, we need to prepare some basic configurations. In the bottom right corner, we can see some basic configurations for a FortiGate firewall cluster. First, we need to specify the operational mode of this cluster. As I mentioned earlier, commonly used is the active standby mode for these two firewalls. This means that at any given time, only one firewall processes traffic, and only when there is an issue with the firewall will all traffic switch to the standby firewall. Of course, running in active mode is also possible, which is more common when we are using VDOMs. For example, since a single firewall may have limited storage, we can have half of the VDOMs operating primarily on the first firewall and the other half on the second firewall. The second configuration is the group ID. The group ID is also a crucial aspect to pay attention to, because when two firewalls form a cluster, they need a virtual MAC address to advertise externally. The group ID is used to generate this virtual MAC address. So when choosing this group ID, we must be careful, especially within the same data center, to ensure that we do not use duplicate group IDs. Otherwise, it could lead to network loops or other strange issues. Next are some security considerations. For example, we can name the HA group, so it's clear at a glance when looking at configurations and to identify which user the cluster belongs to. We will also configure a verification password to prevent unauthorized third parties from forming a cluster with our devices. The next configuration is the heartbeat port, which is used by the devices to send heartbeat messages so they can monitor each other's status. This allows for a timely switchover when problems occur. Of course, there's another configuration not shown here, which is the priority. Priority is also very important, as it directly determines which firewall acts as primary and which as backup in the operational process. Let's look at the specific logic on the next slide. Now, let's examine the logic for primary and backup selection. The logic for primary and backup selection can be divided into two scenarios. On the left is the first scenario, where preemption is disabled, which is also the default configuration. On the right is the second scenario, where preemption is enabled. First, let's look at the left side. When the two firewalls begin to compete for primary and backup roles, they first compare the number of available ports. The firewall with the greater number of available ports will become the primary firewall. If both devices have an equal number of primary available ports, then they will compare their uptime, meaning the firewall that started earlier will become the primary firewall. There's an implicit condition not mentioned here, which is that this condition only applies if the difference in start times between the two devices is more than 5 minutes. This condition holds true if the startup times of the devices are less than 5 minutes apart. Then, generally, the second step will be skipped, and the comparison will directly move to the priority of the two firewalls. Finally, the serial numbers of the two firewalls are compared, with the higher serial number becoming the primary firewall. The right side represents the second scenario, where preemption is enabled. The difference on the right side is that it directly starts with comparing priorities, and then the firewall's uptime. Whereas on the left side, it first compares uptime, then the priority. In regular operations, we mostly use the configuration on the left, which is the firewall's default configuration. Understanding this logic is actually very important for troubleshooting. Sometimes, we can avoid unnecessary switchovers, because although the firewall cluster ensures that operations are largely unaffected, this is actually specific to TCP connections. All TCP connections will be switched from the primary device to the standby device during the switchover. However, some UDP connections will still be lost. Therefore, during the process of troubleshooting, we should try to avoid frequent switching occurrences. So, the above are some basic configurations regarding the firewall. Next, I would like to discuss the considerations during the cluster design process. We need to consider certain issues, especially in terms of network management. We need to consider some issues. Firstly, regarding the management IP, how should we choose it? We know that the two firewalls in the same cluster will share all configurations. This includes the management addresses we might use. So if we share all configurations at the same time, we might only be able to log into the primary firewall, because the configuration is actively displayed on the primary firewall. This might not be very convenient for troubleshooting, although we can log into the standby firewall from the primary firewall via command line. If we could simultaneously log into both the primary and the standby firewall's graphical interfaces at the same time, it would indeed be more convenient for us to manage configurations. Thus, FortiGate firewalls do provide us with such a configuration. That is, after configuring our HA, high availability, we need to enable the HA management status feature. Then, we need to specify a particular port, and the configuration of this specific port is independent for the two firewalls. Specifying a particular port allows each firewall to operate independently. That is, the primary firewall can use one IP address, while the standby firewall can use another IP address. This way, we can achieve the purpose of logging into the graphical interfaces of both firewalls at the same time. The second consideration is regarding the SNMP protocol. We know that the SNMP protocol can help us capture some information from the devices, such as CPU usage and memory usage. It also helps us to promptly identify any issues that arise on the devices. Therefore, in the design of SNMP, we face the same issue as with management addresses. That is, how we can monitor the status of both primary and standby devices simultaneously. Here, FortiGate also provides us with a configuration. First, just like on the left side here, we need to enable the HA management status function under HA. Then, under the SNMP configuration, we need to enable a feature called HA Direct. I will also demonstrate this feature in my experiment shortly. Finally, I want to conduct a simple experiment to demonstrate how to upgrade this firewall cluster and to show some of the content I mentioned earlier. I have set up a relatively simple environment. I used two virtual firewalls to form a cluster. This cluster is connected to two networks. They are the LAN network on the left and the WAN network on the right. The business implementation is quite simple. I can directly ping from the test host in the LAN on the left to the test host in the WAN on the right. First, I would like to show you the configuration of the management IP. Here, I want you all to see I am able to log into these two firewalls independently. Firewall A's address is 10.0.0.200, while Firewall B's address is 10.0.0.201. The configuration I'm using is quite simple. First, under HA, I enabled the HA management status feature and specified port 8, which is the port for 10.0.0.200, serving as the specific port for Firewall A. You can see the configuration here. The second point I want to show everyone is the HA primary standby relationship. We can see that Firewall A has a priority of 200, while Firewall B has a priority of 100. But now we can see Firewall B is the primary and Firewall A is in standby state. The configuration I'm using here is actually its default configuration. Override is disabled. So the main reason B can become the primary is mainly, as you can see here, its uptime is 5 minutes longer than Firewall A's. So in this case, even though Firewall A has a higher priority, we do not compare priorities anymore, because the comparison of uptime takes precedence. Besides the above 2 points, I also want to show everyone the SNMP configuration. Here, I have enabled SNMP v3 to facilitate the demonstration of the HA Direct feature I mentioned earlier. Here, it's best to go to the primary firewall to view the relevant configurations. If we want to fetch the status of both firewalls separately, as mentioned earlier, then we need two configurations. First, under System HA, I need to enable a separate management IP. Second, under the SNMP v3 configuration, specifically under the SNMP user configuration, enable HA Direct. This way, we can capture the status of each firewall separately. Next, let's try it out. We need to turn on this management testing machine. Then we can attempt to capture an SNMP status. Here, I have not configured any authentication requirements. There's quite a lot. We can directly capture its status as we can see. 10.0.0.200 is Firewall A. And we can also capture, separately, Firewall B. If you try to capture using the shared IP at this time, you won't get any information. For example, the IP address used on the firewall now. On the LAN side is 10.0.0.1. We can try running SNMP work from this address. As you can see here, it timed out. The request timed out without any response. We can try again. For example, if I disable the HA Direct here, what kind of result would that produce? We can repeat the experiment above. First, we go to this network management test machine. Initially, Firewall A does not respond. Firewall B also does not respond. So if we test using this shared IP, we can see that it directly returns the device of the primary firewall. Lastly, I want to demonstrate the upgrade process of the cluster or firewall cluster. Generally, during the upgrade process, it's best to first check the uptime of both firewalls. Sometimes, we might encounter some situations where a user's firewall has not been maintained or upgraded for a long time, so its uptime might be a year or even longer. In such cases, I recommend that you do not proceed with the upgrade immediately, but instead restart both firewalls within the upgrade window, because especially some old firewalls are very likely to experience hardware or software failures. Then, you might find the firewall won't start after restarting. So, if you proceed directly with the upgrade, dealing with such a situation would not be very manageable. Therefore, I recommend first checking the uptime. Then, for the upgrade, we must log into the primary firewall to upload our image. The current version I am using is June 4th, 13, and I want to upgrade the firewall to the latest version June 4th, 14. Upload the corresponding version. Using the version here, the target version is 6.4. Generally, we have two ways to upgrade. If we have deployed FortiManager, we can upgrade directly from FortiManager. One good thing about using FortiManager to upgrade is that we don't need to consider the upgrade path issue. Just select the target version, and FortiManager will automatically upgrade through the intermediate versions for us, step by step upgrading to our most important version. The second method is our manual upgrade. With manual upgrading, we need to be mindful of the upgrade path, and we need to download all the necessary images ourselves, then jump from one to save configurations and proceed with the upgrade. It allows us to choose a file for saving the configuration. Next, just wait for the upload to complete. The upload should be finishing any moment now. Under normal circumstances, once we complete the uploaded image will first be transferred from the primary device to the standby device, and then the standby firewall will be upgraded. Here we can take a look. Now B is the primary firewall. We can see it sending the image to the standby firewall, then waiting for the standby to upgrade and restart. On the standby firewall, we can see first, it receives the image from the primary firewall, then it performs some checks on the image, and then it begins the upgrade process. At this point, the primary firewall displays the status as waiting for the standby to restart. Here we can see that the upgrade has been completed and the standby firewall has begun to restart. Once firewall A has completed the upgrade and has restarted, a business switchover will occur. Then firewall B will proceed with the upgrade. You can see the switchover is about to happen. Soon our firewall B will perform the same operations, which are upgrading and restarting. We can log into firewall A. Here we can see the version has now reached June 4th, 14. And currently, firewall A becomes the primary, waiting for firewall B to restart. Firewall B is also restarting now. Firewall B has come back up. Generally, after the upgrade is complete, both firewalls may need to synchronize their configurations. The specific time it takes usually depends on the size of the configuration file. Because we haven't used many configurations here, we can see that both firewalls have synchronized after the upgrade. Next, we can simply test the service. We can ping the peer device again. It might be reachable now. This means our upgrade was successful. So, that's all for today's video. If anyone has any questions or doubts, feel free to leave me a message. Also, I will include the links used in this PPT below this video. See you next time. Goodbye.